Good morning, girls. So again, come back to a new topic. So today's topic is what we call electric flux and Gauss law of electrostatics. So a very important topic for 4 marks. It's a very important question for 4 marks. So the topic will be the electric flux and the Gauss law of electrostatics. Now let's see. Now what do you mean by the electric flux? And then we'll come to the Gauss law of electrostatics. So now let's say, now we got a horizontal electric field of magnitude capital E, or you consider a horizontal electric field of magnitude capital E. So now what I am doing, now inside the electric field or inside the electric field, now let us say I am introducing a closed bounded surface, or what I am doing, now inside the electric field I am introducing a closed bounded surface, now let us say in the form of a tester. So now let us see, now what do you mean by the electric flux, or let us see, now what do you mean by the electric flux, or how to define, now what is the definition of electric flux? So remember, now the electric flux will always be defined the total number of the electric lines of force that will be passing normally to a given surface will be generally called the electric flux. So remember, now the electric flux will always be defined the total number of the electric lines of force that will be passing through, that will be passing normally through a closed surface, or will be generally called the electric flux. So remember, now that will be the definition we got of the electric flux. So once again, now remember, now the electric flux will always be defined the total number of the electric lines of force that will be passing normally through a given surface will be generally called the electric flux. And remember, it will be denoted by a letter phi e, or the symbol for the electric flux will be given by phi e. So now remember one important thing, now the electric flux will be given by the formula. So phi e will be numerically equal to now Ea into cos theta. So remember, now the electric flux will be given by the formula. So phi e will be numerically equal to now Ea cos theta. So now you already know, now E will be the electric field vector. Now E will be, it is called the area vector, and theta will be the angle between the field vector and the area vector. So remember, so electric flux will be given by the general formula. So phi E will be numerically equal to Ea cos theta. So remember, knowing this formula, now E will be denoting the electric field vector. Now E will be the area vector and theta will be the angle between the both the vectors. So remember, now that is the formula we got for the electric flux. Now coming on to one more important thing. Now can anybody tell me what will be the direction of the electric field? So already given the direction of the electric field will be horizontal, or the direction of the electric field will be fixed. So already given the direction of the electric field will be horizontal. Now similarly, the most important thing, now what will be the direction of the area vector, or what will be the direction of the area vector? So now remember very carefully, now what will be the direction of the area vector? So the direction of the area vector will be normal to the plane of the surface. So remember, the direction of the area vector will be normal to the plane of the surface, now acting outward. So always now remember, so the direction of the area vector will always be normal to the plane of the surface but acting outward. So remember, now that will be the direction we got for the area vector. So very important thing. So remember, the direction of the electric field is already fixed. So the direction of the electric field will be horizontal. And remember, now the direction of the area vector will be given by normal to the plane of the surface, or the direction of the area vector will be normal to the plane of the surface and acting outward. So remember, now that will be the direction we got for the area vector. So once again, now remember, the electric flux will be given by the general formula. So phi E will be numerically equal to Ea cos theta, where capital E will be electric field vector, A will be the area vector, and theta will be the angle between the field vector and the area vector. And remember, now as far as the direction will be concerned, now the direction of the field vector will be horizontal, and the direction of the area vector will be normal to the plane of the surface but acting outward. So remember, now that will be the direction we got for the field vector, now as well for the area vector. Now further, now what I can do? Now further, I can write the above formula. So I can also write the above formula. Now phi E will be numerically equal to, now you already know, now what is the formula for the dot product of two vectors. Now A bar dot B bar will be numerically equal to AB cos theta. So you are already familiar the dot product of the two vectors will be given by the formula. So A bar dot B bar will be numerically equal to now AB cos theta. That is the reason why now EA cos theta can be written as the dot product of the electric field vector and the area vector. So now remember, now we are getting now another definition, or now we are getting now another definition for the electric flux. So electric flux can also be defined as the dot product of the field vector and the area vector. So remember from this formula, now we are getting now another definition for the electric flux. So the electric flux can also be defined as the dot product of the field vector and the area vector. So always remember, so the electric flux can also be defined as the dot product of the field vector and the area vector. Now coming on to now one more important point, or coming on to now one more important point. Now the next important thing will be, now what will be the SI unit of the electric flux, or what will be now the SI unit of the electric flux. So remember, now the SI unit of the electric flux will be given by Weber. Or remember, now the SI unit of the electric flux will be generally called as Weber. So remember, now that will be the SI unit required for the electric flux. So the SI unit for the electric flux will be generally called a Weber. So now once you know about the electric flux, or once you know about the definition of the electric flux, now let us come to now one more important point. So now we got some special cases. So now we got some special cases, now meaning. So now we got some special cases, now meaning, now when the electric flux will become maximum and when the electric flux will become minimum. So now let us say the two special cases, now when the electric flux will become maximum and when the electric flux will become minimum. So very simple, now you already know now the first special case. So you already know when theta will be numerically equal to 0 degree, or when theta will be equal to 0 degree, so therefore the maximum electric flux will be given by the formula. So EA into cos 0 degree, so cos 0 will be equal to 1. That's the reason why the maximum electric flux will be given by the formula now E into A. So now very simple thing. So remember, now whenever the angle theta will be zero, or whenever the angle theta will be equal to 0 degree, then cos 0 degree will be numerically equal to 1. That's the reason why the electric flux will become maximum, that will be numerically equal to Ea. Now this is what we call the mathematical part, or this is the mathematical part. But what will be the actual meaning of theta will be equal to 0 degree, or what will be the actual meaning we got? Now theta will be numerically equal to 0 degree. So very simple. Now what I will do, I will take the closed surface, and what I will do, I will insert the closed surface. Now in this manner, or what I will do, I will take the closed surface, and now I will be keeping the closed surface now in this manner. So now you already know now what will be the direction of the electric field. So the direction of the electric field. So the direction of the electric field will be horizontal. And can you tell me now what will be the direction of the area vector? So you already know the direction of the area vector will be normal to the plane of the surface, but acting outward. So you already know now the direction of the area vector will be normal to the plane of the surface, but acting outward. So now what is happening here? Now in this case, now the field vector and the area vector, now both of them will become parallel to each other, or in this case, the field vector and the area vector will be parallel to each other. That is the reason why the angle between them will be 0 degree. Cos 0 degree will be numerically equal to 1. That's the reason why the electric flux will become maximum, that will be numerically equal to now E into A. So once again, now remember the important concept. Now what is the meaning we got? For theta will be numerically equal to 0 degree, or what is the meaning of theta will be equal to 0 degree. So remember, now whenever I am keeping the closed surface now in this manner, then what will happen? Now already the direction of the electric field will be horizontal. So now you already know the direction of the electric field will be horizontal, but what will be the direction of the area vector? So you already know the direction of the area vector will be normal to the plane of the given surface, but acting outward. So always remember that direction of the area vector will be perpendicular to the plane of the surface, but acting outward. So as a result, now what will happen? Now both the field vector and the area vector will be acting in the same direction, or both the field vector and the area vector will be parallel or to each other. That's the reason why the angle between them will become 0 degree. That's the reason why cos 0 will be numerically equal to 1. So therefore, the electric flux will always be maximum. That will be given by the formula. So phi max will be numerically equal to now E into A. So that is the first case we got. So when the electric flux will become maximum. Similarly, now the second special case, now when the electric flux will become zero, or when the electric flux will become zero. So very simple, now what I will do, so when theta will be numerically equal to 90 degree, or when theta will be equal to 90 degree, then what will happen to the flux? So phi minimum will be numerically equal to now EA into cos 90 degree. So cos 90 degree will be equal to 0. That's the reason why the electric flux will become 0. So therefore, now the electric flux will become 0. So once again, now remember, now whenever now theta will be numerically equal to 90 degree, or whenever the angle theta will be numerically equal to 90 degree, then remember, now cos 90 degree will always be equal to 0. That's the reason why the electric flux will also become 0. So now, what is the physical meaning of that, or what will be the physical meaning of the God? So fairly simple. Now what I will do, now in spite of now keeping the closed surface in this manner, now what I will do, I will keep the closed surface now in this manner. So what I am doing, now in spite of keeping the closed surface now in this manner, now what I am doing, I am keeping the surface now in this manner. So now, can you tell me, now what will be the angle between the field vector and the area vector? So you already know the field vector will be horizontal. Now what will be the direction of the area vector? So remember, the direction of the area vector will be normal to the plane of the surface, but acting outward. So always remember, the direction of the area vector will be normal to the plane of the surface but acting outward. So meaning what? So the angle between the field vector and the area vector will be 90 degrees. That's the reason why cos 90 degrees will be equal to 0. That's the reason why now the flux will become 0 or the electric flux will become 0. So now therefore you need to remember the important point, or you need to remember. So you need to remember the important point. So remember, now whenever the field vector and the area vector will be parallel to each other, or remember, now whenever the field vector and the area vector will be parallel to each other, then the angle between them will be 0 degree. So cos 0 degree will be equal to 1. That's the reason why the electric flux will become maximum. On the other hand, now remember, now whenever the field vector and the area vector, or whenever the field vector and the area vector will be perpendicular or to each other, then the angle between them will be 90 degrees. So cos 90 degrees will be 0. That's the reason why the electric flux will become 0. So therefore, so remember the important point. So whenever the field vector and the area vector are parallel to each other, or whenever the field vector and the area vector are parallel to each other, then the angle between them will be 0 degree. So cos 0 degree will be equal to 1. That's the reason why the electric flux will become maximum. On the other hand, now whenever the field vector and the area vector, or whenever the field vector and the area vector are mutually perpendicular to each other, then the angle between them will be 90 degrees. That's the reason why cos 90 degrees will be equal to 0. That's the reason why the electric flux will also become 0. So remember, now that is, so remember, now those are the special cases we got. Now when the electric flux will become maximum, and when the electric flux will become minimum or 0. So now that is what we call the concept of electric flux. So remember, now that is the concept we got for the electric flux. So now coming on to one more important thing. Now listen very carefully. Now coming on to one more important thing. Now let us say we got a positive charge. Now let us say we got a positive charge. Now what I'm doing? I'm drawing a closed surface around the positive charge. So let us say we got a positive charge, and what I am doing, I am drawing a closed surface around the positive charge. So remember, the closed surface generally called the Gaussian surface. Or remember, this closed surface will be generally called the Gaussian surface. So remember, what I am doing, consider a positive charge. What I am doing, I am drawing a closed surface surrounding the positive charge. So remember, this a closed surface will be generally called the Gaussian surface. So now the important thing will be, can anybody tell me what will be the electric lines of force due to the positive charge, or how the electric lines of force due to a positive charge. So remember, due to a positive charge, all the lines of force will be radially outwards. Or remember, due to the positive charge, so all the lines of force will be radially outwards. So now what is the meaning of that? So the meaning of that will be, so all the lines of force, all the electric lines of force will be radially outward, or all of the electric lines of force, they will always be radially outward. So remember, this very important concept. So remember, due to the positive charge, all the lines of force will be radially outwards. Or we can also say, due to the positive charge, the lines of force will be diverging from the Gaussian surface. So therefore, remember the important thing, due to the positive charge, all the lines of force will be radially outwards. Or we can also say, due to the positive charge, all the lines of force will be diverging from the Gaussian surface. So remember, that will be the lines of force we got due to the positive charge. Similarly, let us say you got a negative charge. Let us say you got a negative charge. What I will do, I will draw a Gaussian surface around it. So now, can anybody tell me what will be the lines of force due to the negative charge? So remember, due to the negative charge, so all the lines of force will be radially inwards. Or we can also say, due to the negative charge, now all the lines of force will be converging into the Gaussian surface. So meaning what? So if I draw the lines of force, so all are the lines of force. So if I draw the lines of force, so the direction of the lines of force will be inward, or the direction of the lines of force will be inward. So remember this important point, now due to a negative charge. So remember, now all the lines of force will be radially inward, or due to the negative charge, now all the lines of force will be converging into the Gaussian surface. So this is a very important point you need to remember in order to understand the Gauss law of electrostatics. So you need to remember this fundamental point. So once again I'm repeating, so listen very carefully. So remember, now due to the positive charge, or remember, now due to the positive charge, now all the lines of force will be radially outward, or due to the positive charge, so all the lines of force will be diverging from the Gaussian surface. On the other hand, now due to the negative charge, now all the lines of force will be radially inward, or all the lines of force will be converging into the Gaussian surface. So once again, now remember very simple thing. So remember now due to the positive charge, so all the lines of force will be radially outward, or all the lines of force will be diverging from the Gaussian surface. On the other hand, now due to the negative charge, now all the lines of force will be radially inward, or all the lines of force will be converging into the Gaussian surface. So remember, now that will be the important point. So you need to remember now regarding the lines of force, now due to the positive charge and the negative charge. So now once you are familiar with this concept, or once you are familiar with this particular concept, now let us come to the very important thing. Now that we are calling, so what we call the Gauss law of electrostatics, or we call the Gauss law of electrostatics. So now once you have understood the previous concept, so now you can understand now very well now what will be the Gauss law of electrostatics. So now let us see now what will be the statement we got, or what will be the statement we got for the Gauss law. So remember, so according to the Gauss law, the total number of the electric lines of force either entering the Gaussian surface or leaving the Gaussian surface will be numerically equal to 1 by epsilon naught times the net charge that will be enclosed by the Gaussian surface. So once again, now remember, so what will be the statement of Vygotsky, or what will be the statement of Vygotsky for the Gauss law? So according to Gauss law, the total number of the electric lines of force either entering the Gaussian surface or leaving the Gaussian surface will be numerically equal to 1 by epsilon naught times the net charge that will be enclosed by the Gaussian surface. So once again I am repeating that definition. So according to the Gauss law, the total number of the electric lines of force either entering the Gaussian surface or leaving the Gaussian surface will be numerically equal to 1 by epsilon naught times the net charge that will be enclosed by the Gaussian surface. So meaning what? So now meaning, now mathematically, so now meaning what? So mathematically, so mathematically, so I can write the Gauss law, so the total electric flux, now phi E will be numerically equal to 1 by epsilon naught times the net charge that will be enclosed by the Gaussian surface, or phi E will be numerically equal to, you can write now Q naught, now divided by epsilon naught. So remember, now this will be the mathematical expression we got, or this will be the mathematical formula we got for the Gauss law. So once again, now remember the statement for the Gauss law, the total number of the lines of force either entering into the Gaussian surface or leaving the Gaussian surface will be numerically equal to 1 by epsilon naught times the net charge that will be enclosed by the Gaussian surface. So that is the reason why, so I can write the mathematical formula, so phi E will be numerically equal to now Q net, now divided by epsilon naught. So once again, remember the statement. So remember, so according to the Gauss law, the total number of the electric lines of force either entering into the Gaussian surface or leaving the Gaussian surface will be numerically equal to 1 by epsilon naught times the net charge that will be enclosed by the Gaussian surface. So that is reason why, so mathematically, so I can write, so phi e will be numerically equal to 1 by epsilon naught into q net, or phi e will be numerically equal to now q net now divided by epsilon naught. So remember, now that is what we call the that is what we call the Gauss law of electrostatics. So meaning what? So according to the Gauss law, the electric flux will only be possible, or according to Gauss law, the electric flux will only be possible when the Gaussian surface will be enclosing some amount of net charge. So meaning what? So according to Gauss law, the electric flux will only be possible now whenever the Gaussian surface will be enclosing some amount of net charge. So meaning what? So whenever the net charge that will be enclosed by the Gaussian surface will be zero, then automatically the electric flux will also become zero. So therefore, now try to understand now what will be the meaning of the Gauss law. So according to Gauss law, the electric flux will only be possible, or the electric flux will only be possible now whenever the Gaussian surface will be enclosing some amount of net charge. So whenever the net charge that will be enclosed by the Gaussian surface will become zero, then the electric flux will also become zero. So remember, now that is what we call the Gauss law of electrostatics. So now, let us say, a Gaussian surface will be enclosing now 1 coulomb of positive charge. So now, can anybody not tell me now how many number of lines of force that will be diverging out from the Gaussian surface? Or can anybody not tell me now how many number of the lines of force that will be diverging from the Gaussian surface? So once again, now remember, now let us say the Gaussian surface will be containing 1 coulomb of the positive charge, or 1 coulomb positive charge is kept under the Gaussian surface. So now, can anybody not tell me now how many number of the lines of force that will be diverging from the Gaussian surface? So can anybody now tell me now how many number of the lines of force that will be diverging out from the Gaussian surface? So very simple, now apply the formula. So you apply the formula. So you already know now that electric flux will be numerically equal to now Q, or we call phi E will be numerically equal to Q net divided by epsilon naught. So therefore the electric flux will be numerically equal to now Q net is already given 1 coulomb of charge. So Q net is already given 1 coulomb now divided by epsilon naught. So remember now what is the value of epsilon naught. So you already know epsilon naught will be given by 8.85 into 10 power minus 12. Or if you simplify, so what we get, so phi E will be numerically equal to now 10 power 12 now divided by 8.85, or this can also be written now phi E will be numerically equal to, if I remove the decimal, so what you get now 100 divided by 885 now multiplied by 10 power 12, or we can also write now phi E will be numerically equal to 1000 divided by 885 now multiplied by 10 power 11. So what 10 I am taking here, so I can write now 1000 are divided by 885 into 10 power 11. Now you already know now 1000 are divided by 885. If you calculate, so you will be getting around now 1.13 into 10 power 11, or I can write now phi E will be numerically equal to now 113 into 10 power 9. And you remember now what is the unit of the electric flux, or you remember now what is the SI unit of the electric flux. So the SI unit of the electric flux will be Weber. So remember now this will be the number of lines of force, or this many number of the lines of force that will be diverging out from the Gaussian surface. So always now remember the concept, so whenever the Gaussian surface will be containing 1 coulomb of the positive charge, then the number of the lines of force that will be diverging out from the Gaussian surface will be numerically equal to 113 into 10 power 9 Weber. So that is what I am trying to explain you. So about the Gauss law. So therefore now remember the important thing. So remember, so whenever the Gaussian surface, or whenever the Gaussian surface will be containing a charge of 1 coulomb, or whenever the Gaussian surface will be consisting of now 1 coulomb of positive charge, then remember the total number of the lines of force that will be diverging out from the Gaussian surface will be numerically equal to now 113 into 10 power 9 Weber. So remember, that's a simple problem, we can say, to understand now what is called or what is the meaning we want for the Gauss law. So now coming on to one more important thing. We generally call the significance of Gauss law. Let us see what will be the significance of the Gauss law, or what will be the importance of the Gauss law. You can remember in 3 points, so you need not learn a lot about it. So remember the significance of the Gauss law can be remembered in 3 important points. So now what will be the first point we got? So remember, the first point will be, now whenever the Gaussian surface, whenever the net charge that will be enclosed by the Gaussian surface will be positive, then remember the electric flux will always be radially outward. So you already know this point. Now that will become the significance of the Gauss law. So remember the first point. So whenever the net charge that will be enclosed by the Gaussian surface will be positive, then the electric flux will always be radially outward. Similarly, what will be the second important point? So remember the second important point. Whenever the net charge that will be enclosed by the Gaussian surface will be negative, then the electric flux will always be radially inward. So remember the second important point under significance. Whenever the net charge that will be enclosed by the Gaussian surface will be negative, then the electric flux will always be radially inverse. Similarly, what is the third important point? So remember, the third important point will be, whenever the net charge that will be enclosed by the Gaussian surface will be zero, then the electric flux will also be zero. So remember the third point. So whenever the net charge that will be enclosed by the Gaussian surface will be zero, then the electric flux will also become zero. Now this will become the significance of the Gauss law, or that is what we call the importance of Gauss law. So remember the importance of the Gauss law. The first point, so whenever the net charge that will be enclosed by the Gaussian surface will be positive, then the electric flux will always be radially outward. Similarly, the second point, whenever the net charge that will be enclosed by the Gaussian surface will be negative, then the electric flux will always be radially inward. And remember the last point. So whenever the net charge that will be enclosed by the Gaussian surface will become zero, then the electric flux will also become zero. So remember, that is the importance we got for the Gauss law. So whenever the net charge that will be enclosed by the Gaussian surface will be positive, then the electric flux will be radially outward. Now whenever the net charge that will be enclosed by the Gaussian surface will be negative, then the electric flux will be radially inward. And whenever the net charge that will be enclosed by the Gaussian surface will be zero, then the electric flux will also become zero. So remember, now that will be the significance we got for the Gauss law. So remember, very 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 important question for 4 marks. Several times it came in IP. State Gauss law of electrostatics and explain the importance of the Gauss law. So very very important one. So very important 4 mark question. So go through once again. So all of you might have understood. So once again now go through. So that's all for today. So again we'll meet very soon. So thank you. Thank you very much.